And welcome to a new buyer's guide based on CD players, hopefully one of many in the future. I'll be sifting through a series of points which will hopefully help anyone out there looking to buy a new CD player. After that, I'll be looking at a selection of recommended CD players. This is not a technology best of list, I hasten to add. Some viewers seem to have got the wrong end of the stick on that one. Apart from price, there's no grades and no 10 to 1 countdown. The hardware merely serves to make you aware of what's out there. In fact, I'll need your help to make this list a little bit more comprehensive. Now, I'm recording this video right before Christmas, so let's begin this video smack dab in the Christmas spirit. So let us bathe in the magic of the event and retain the jolly atmosphere. Why bother? Really, why bother? CD is no more, isn't it? It doesn't even have the feel-good, high-morale appellation of Renaissance that's been recently glued to the vinyl format, despite that format's tiny sales figures. The only word glued to CD is dead. If you only look at the US market from a year 2000 sales high of almost 1 billion units sold, last year those sales figures hit the heady lows of just over 45 million. Figures that resemble those achieved around 1986, incidentally. The onrushing streaming standards have devastated the CD as a prime music carrier, and words like nail and coffin abound. So I ask again, why bother? Why bother buying a CD player? Why push good money after bad? Okay then, I'll take up that challenge on your behalf. I'll tell you why you need to buy a CD player and a new one at that. Firstly, let's step back from the headlines and the emotion and take a broader view. There's a difference between a mass market anything and a specialist item. And let's recognize the fact that CD is rapidly becoming a specialist item. After all, there are some young people out there who've never touched a CD player and would struggle to know how to use one. Now, just because a product moves from a mass market categorization to a niche market, it's no cause for alarm. Call it maturity, if you like. The world is full of niche products that do not sell in the billions, support a relatively small industry, and bring in a tidy profit for those involved, while happily serving a smiling customer base. In our hi-fi and music world, vinyl is one such niche product. It's no longer a mass market medium. It sells relatively few in number in global terms, yet it does very nicely, thank you. Not only do artists record for it, record labels support it, pressing plants work on it, new pressing plants open their doors, shops sell it, hi-fi brands produce turntables, tone arms, cartridges, and phono amps for it, cleaning products and record cleaning machines are released for it, and we buy it. Yes, for such a niche product, vinyl does very well for itself. And as I say, CD is entering that stage in its life. It's becoming a niche product. Now, it ain't there just yet. It tends to sell rather too many to be called, strictly speaking, a niche product, but it's on the way. And personally, I can't wait. Now, why is that? Well, because then CD will be finally free of those who hang off it to make a profit, stifling improvements along the way. Now, what do I mean by stifling improvements? Well, when you have a mass market product, most people gather around it, not because they care about the item itself, but to make lots of money. You see, when you're looking to sell any product, that particular product only has to be good enough. Good enough to sell. Good enough to make lots of money. Now, if the product is too good, if you place too much research and development, time, effort, and dollars and pounds into it, then the pinstripes don't like it. Why? Because all they want to do is make lots of money. Now, like rats from a sinking ship, they're deserting CD and climbing aboard HMS Digital, which means that those who actually love the CD format can get to work in peace and quiet and turn that format into something it should have been all along. The geeky, nerdy, talented innovators will be let loose on the format to improve and enhance sound quality in technological terms. Believe me, CD has legs. In sonic terms, it ain't finished yet. Right now, well, even now, I prefer to listen to CD than streaming and other digital sources. Digital is incredibly immature as a sound format. Give it another 20 years and it might amount to something, but right now, well, it's still a baby. CD, that is, CD done well, sounds far better right now. For digital, it doesn't matter how impressive is your sampling rate, that's no guarantee of sound quality, because in broad terms, the integrity of the data is not secure, and more importantly, is not consistent. Now, CD is far more secure, reliable, and consistent as a digital source carrier. But why is this? Because the CD disc itself was precisely defined almost 40 years ago, as was the way you pull the information off that carrier disc, you decode the data, and you play that same data through a set of, again, defined cabling and connectors. While all of these areas had their issues early on, they all had time to mature, and that's what they've done. They are all relatively simple technologies, and each exists within specific boundaries, and they are all still improving. Compare that to modern digital play with its mess of file types, multiple data transfer methods, how they relate and interact with each other, changes almost by the day. Well, if I could describe in one word the current state of digital play right now, it would be this: inconsistent. Now, of course, digital music will hit the audiophile heights. It's inevitable. It will come. But as far as I'm concerned, it ain't happened yet, and it won't happen for a while. Now, there's been some good work done in the digital domain. There's lots of talent working in the digital field, and great strides have occurred within it. But right now, digital sound quality can be termed as good, because it certainly ain't great. I spend more time being disappointed by digital than I do being wowed. But as I say, give it time. So let's recap. Vinyl is around, what, 70 years old right now? So it should sound brilliant. And it does. CD is around 40 years old, as I've said. And so it should be hitting its sonic peak around now. As for digital, well, it's hardly out of its nappies yet. We need to give it time, which is another reason why CD deserves your attention. Even in the past year, I've seen and heard CD highlights that have impressed. Part of that is down to the increasing quality of the analog to digital converters used in record studios, places like Abbey Road, while CD players have also improved in quality. Specifically, the improvement of CD transport technology, associated DAC technology, including preamp technology in CD players to enable direct connections to power amplifiers, the use of valves in CD players, noise reducing chassis design, and more. And let's not forget here, CD sales still remain worldwide in the hundreds of millions. And I looked at a recent BBC report that said there exists right now 200 billion CDs on planet Earth. That's a lot. So you're not about to go short anytime soon. So let's say you're looking to buy. What do you do? Well, firstly, budget is a major factor. Generally, the more you spend, the better the performance. Also, new tends to be better than second-hand in strict sonic terms. This is partly to do with the build and component quality, but also the amount of anti-noise work done inside the actual chassis, a factor that was either little known or ignored when there was so much money to be made and little time to devote to product design. So older CD players didn't really address the notion of jitter, high frequency noise and vibration back in those days. And that, let's not forget, is partly where the notion of the harsh metallic CD sound came from. Remember that? The last time I heard an old CD player, I had to plug in about, well, a dozen grounding accessories to suck out a ton of digital noise to make it sound even vaguely listenable. Such was the brightness of the mids and the chrome-plated bass. In fact, you don't really see dirt cheap new CD players anymore, and I'm talking about £150 or less. Low-cost CD players tend to be part of something else, or possibly a worse than useless cheap Chinese machine you can pick up for a few pounds in your local supermarket sitting next to the yogurts. This is why a new or recently released Audiophile CD player is a good thing. Also because dedicated and specialist CD players are no longer mass market items, because they're not being built to a price and thrown out the door anymore, the design is now more considered, careful and precise. Today's CD players are being built with sound quality in mind, instead of only banks of flashing lights and acres of aluminium. All-in-one integrated models are excellent now, offering great value. They minimize footprint, simplify installation, and are easy to use. If your CD player includes a preamp and you can plug it directly into a power amp, then all the better. That removes your Hi-Fi's preamp from your basic Hi-Fi chain, simplifying the signal path and increasing sound quality. Even better in sonic terms is the use of a separate transport and a separate DAC, each in their own chassis and connected by a cable such as a coax. The future of CD is, to my audiophile mind, full of possibilities and promise in technological terms. But there's one very important factor that not many people have talked about, and that's how CD discs themselves are produced. There is growing evidence that variations in the type of manufacturing can have a bearing on final sound quality, with jitter or timing issues actually being pressed onto the disc itself from a less than perfect manufacturing process. Now, it's at this point I'd like to credit a guy named Robert Harley, who produced an excellent feature for the American Hi-Fi magazine Stereophile back in 2004. Now, I'll put a link to his feature in the description, but more people need to read it, especially Hi-Fi manufacturers and also CD pressing plants. Let me quote just a small part of it. And I quote, according to some listeners, discs made by PDO, which is Philips DuPont's optical corporation, sounds better than discs made by other manufacturing facilities. This could be attributed to the fact that PDO uses a slightly different process in creating the center hole. Instead of molding the disc with the hole, it is punched after the disc has been made. So for most manufacturers, a hole would be molded into this aluminium disc. What PDO did was to create the aluminium disc with no hole, then they would punch a hole through the center. The idea being that the punch method created a perfect circle. Apparently, molding a hole in the center of a CD disc creates a less than perfect circle. Now, this means that the sensor on your CD player is constantly hunting as the disc rotates, and the electrical current supporting that sensor tends to pulse because the servo is constantly looking for more power to do that hunting, all of which apparently affects sound quality. Now, whatever your thoughts are on that theory, as Robert Harley states, at any rate, the ramifications of this theory are so far-reaching that a full investigation is called for. And frankly, I'm in full agreement with that. But what other reasons are there to look at buying a new CD player? At the consumer level, the music industry still uses CD a lot as part of its ongoing reissue plans for reissued archival works. It's also perfect as part of a presentation high-value box set. I received a press release for one such new release as I was making this video. New CDs are also relatively cheap to manufacture. If you're a new or niche band and you want your music on a physical format and you struggle to find the cash for vinyl, CD is a great alternative. I would say, in that case, there's never been a better time to buy yourself a new CD player. So what CD player should you buy? Here's a broad selection for you to consider from three different price points. This is just a suggested list and no more. There are lots of others that I have not been able to include due to space reasons, which is why I need your help. If you don't see your favorite CD player in this video, then please jot it down in the comments section below. If you just want to write a name and model number, then that's fine. If you also want to tell me why you like that CD player, then that'd be great too. This will help this guide become more of a resource for other prospective buyers in the future and may very well influence their buying decision, which is what this buyer's guide is all about after all, helping those who might be interested in buying a CD player all of their very own. So we'll start off with a pretty broad price range to begin with, shall we? We'll start from zero to £1,000. The first model is a CD transport, and it's from a company called Audiolab, priced at £369. Possibly the basis for the best value CD player you can buy, up to around £3,000, or even possibly more, depending on the DAC and your coax cable. This CD transport basically is, how can I describe it? Well, it's a stunner in terms of sound, with an oft-ignored noise-treated coax port at its very heart. Next up, we're looking at £629, and this one is from Riga, and it's called the Apollo. A retro-looking top-loader now that resembles a Brio amplifier. The interface is not the most stylish, and it uses an older Wolfson WM8742 DAC chip, but it benefits from the bespoke Riga software, disc reading performance, and its lack of frills. Offering a rich sound, it's not particularly bass heavy, but mids are very smooth. This next one isn't really sold anymore, but I'm sure you can pick it up on eBay and other secondhand sites. This is a little known CD from a very well known valve amplifier manufacturer in the UK called Icon Audio. It's the CD X1, one of the great lost CD players of recent times. Never fully promoted by Icon Audio. Why? God knows. Featuring similar circuits to that company's PS3 phono amplifier, with separate digital and analog sections, a choke regulated power supply, and even a valve regulator. With a Class A triode output stage, it's a winner. Call the company. They may still have a few in a dark, dusty corner somewhere. And for the next three, we're going to up the ante. We're going to go from £1,000 to £2,000. At £1,200, we're looking at the Quad Artera Play Plus. This includes a preamp, so it can be connected directly to a power amplifier. It also features Bluetooth and a headphone amp. It also includes an ESS Sabre ES90 1/8 DAC, supporting 384 kHz PCM and DSD 256. Its quality op amps and toroidal transformer aid its cultured sound quality. And now a CD player that doesn't get enough love. This one is £1,300 from Roxanne. It's the K3 CD-DI. It's a few years old now, but it still performs, featuring a precision crystal master clock and a 24-bit 192 kHz DAC. This front loader is well made and pretty balanced in terms of play, with a spacious soundstage, but it retains confidence around the lower frequencies. Resident in the Welsh Valleys is Lima, and its CD player at £1,400 called Elements. The Lima is resident in a half-width chassis. It's a simple beast that does the simple things very well. With that chassis style, it's ideal for small spaces and awkward layouts. The sonic elements of the Lima have been carefully designed, with a focus on lowering nasty noise to provide a smooth and detailed performance. And now the final trio, where we go from £2,000 to goodness knows where. This one is £2,600. It's another transport. It's from a company called CEC and it's called the TL5. This is one I'm hearing good things about and I'm trying to call one in for a review. It's a Japanese-made CD transport that is bereft of bells and whistles. It does just one job, playing CDs, and that's music to my ears, hopefully in more ways than one. It even has a top-loading lid for transport access to remove any vibration monster draw mechanism, and it supports a balanced connection. I like the look of this one. Next, we're looking at the Luxman D03X at £3,500. The Luxman is almost two CD players in one because the single-ended and balanced connections change this sonic envelope. There's certainly nothing wishy-washy here. Luxman provides you with a definite pair of sound attributes for both outputs. This is a good-looking, feature-packed, well-designed and great-sounding CD player. If you have 3.5 big ones looking to go digital, give the Luxman D03X a close look. And finally, we're looking at the Macintosh MCD600, which is priced at £5 short of £8,000. This one supports SACD, USB, a high drive headphone amplifier, a quad balanced mode, and also supports data DVD to enable sound file play straight from a DVD disc, which to my mind is a brilliant addition. If you buy the MCD600 to connect to your hi-fi, bypass the preamp, go straight to the power amplifier if you have one. The sonic results are truly worth it. And that, my friends, is the end of that. That's the end of this CD buyer's guide. I hope I've given you a few things to at least think about and consider. Thank you very much for staying to the end of this video. Please consider clicking on the subscribe button below, and while you're in a button pressing mood, you may also want to hit the like. Now, I will be back next week with another video, and I'd like to have your company there as well. So please join me then. Until that time, bye bye for now.